everybody. My name is Cherno Cisse Jr. I am a professor in the Department of Religious Studies here at DePaul University. On behalf of the Center for World Catholicism and Intercultural Theology, I want to welcome DePaul students and faculty, members of the Office of Black Catholics, anybody who is a member of the Chicago Archdiocese, or faculty or students from the Catholic Theological Union, and anyone else who is attending because of your interest in the story of Father Augustus Tolton. So again, thank you all for being here. I'll keep my introductory remarks about Father Tolton brief, just because we're going to hear a lot more about him from Bishop Perry and from our essay award winner. But I will say a few things, okay? It's vital and even imperative that we reflect on the history and meaning of Father Augustus Tolton's life and Catholic belief. And I'll give three reasons why I think this is important. The first is that Catholicism has played a significant historical role in defining religious and racial identity and community throughout the African diaspora. And its importance in various parts of Africa today, for example, is only increasing. Okay. Second, many Catholics who are not black do not know about Father Tolton. Correcting this lack of knowledge will only support those efforts within Catholicism to reinforce those bonds and bridges of belief and practice that cohere an incredibly diverse global community. That being the Catholic Church. Third, but certainly not least, and even perhaps most important for our purposes today, Father Tolton's story has represented and will continue to represent an inspirational model, not just for all Catholics, but in fact for all people devoted to equality and democracy, and who are interested in finding examples of exceptional determination, benevolence, and ethical good. Okay. So with that, and given that Bishop Joseph N. Perry is leading the process to canonize Father Augustus Tolton, that Bishop Perry is himself such an important leader, not just for black Catholics, but for all Catholics. And given that Bishop Perry, I think, forgive me, but will play a central role in fact, future histories and theological reflections about American Catholicism, I think you deserve a few words of introduction. From an early age, Bishop Perry knew that a deeply religious life would be his calling and his focus. Bishop Perry was born here in our Windy City, April 18, 1948. Forgive me for giving the date. But you don't look a day over 35. He was born into an African-American Catholic family. He attended Chicago Catholic schools, and for a year he enrolled at George Washington Carver High School. In an interview, Bishop Perry explained that as early as the age of 9, he knew that he wanted to be a priest. He was ordained a priest in the Archdiocese of Milwaukee on May 24, 1975. His episcopal ordination occurred in Chicago on June 29, 1998, making him both titular Bishop of Lead, an historic former see in South Dakota, and auxiliary to His Eminence, Francis Cardinal George, Archbishop of Chicago. Father Perry's resume of theological and legal training is impressively exhaustive, to say the least. It includes graduation from St. Joseph College in Rensselaer, Indiana, where he received a BA in philosophy. A BA in theology, and a minor in education. So for any of you who are interested, if you're not already, double majoring, or majoring, minoring, or he's the person to talk to. And so he received his MDiv from St. Francis de Sales Major Seminary in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, and a licentiate in canon law from the Catholic University of America in Washington, D.C. Father Perry has taught graduate level courses in canon canon law and education at Sacred Heart School of Theology in Hales Corners, Wisconsin, St. Mary of the Lake Seminary in Mundelein, Illinois, and Marquette University School of Law in Marquette, Wisconsin. He has also served in church courts as an advocate and judge, and as a conciliation and arbitration officer. Bishop Perry's vita of pastoral service and professional membership is extremely comprehensive and too long to completely recount here. However, some highlights would have to include his 13-year pastorship of All Saints Church in Milwaukee, Wisconsin, his 12-year position as the Chief Judicial Officer of the Tribunal for the Archdiocese of Milwaukee, his current membership on the United States Conference of Catholic Bishops Committee on Education, his current chairmanship of the USCCB Committee on African American Catholics, and his service as the standing Vice President of the Board for the Black Catholic Congress, situated in Baltimore, Maryland. As Auxiliary Bishop, Bishop Perry stands as the current Episcopal Vicar for Vicariate 6 of the Archdiocese of Chicago. What does that mean in terms of numbers? I'll tell you what that means. It means that he has to keep track of and lead 75 parishes, 2 missions, an oratory, 55 elementary schools, 7 secondary schools, 96 priests, and approximately 250,000 Catholics. So the fact that you've been able to make time actually amidst all of that, we are sincerely welcome. Father Perry has and continues to serve as an exemplary leader, educator, adjudicator, pastor, and priest. His career represents a uniquely impressive combination of vision, leadership, and humble advocacy for African-American Catholicism, religious toleration, and social justice. For all of these reasons, it is completely appropriate that Bishop Perry is the official organizer and leader for the cause for the sainthood of Father Augustus Tolton. On behalf of all of us, I want to thank you, Bishop Perry, for being here.
Thank you very much. My pleasure to be here. This is our second essay contest program that we've had here at DePaul that myself have been invited to. And I want to thank each and every one of you for your interest in the touching story of Father Augustus Tolton. I think he's a remarkable figure, not only from history, a history that demonstrates a less tolerant age that you and I are accustomed to, but one for which periodically we turn the pages of the history book to understand some of the dark things of the past and how we related to one another and how far we have come, as well as how far we still have to go in terms of social, ethnic, racial diversity in our multicultural society of the United States of America. Chicago, of course, is no stranger to saints walking in streets. We've had two remarkable women who have been recently proclaimed saints who walked our streets. One was Frances Mary Cabrini, who was sent here in the late 1880s by Pope Leo XIII to minister to Italian immigrants who were settling in the United States. And she principally traveled the trains and the streetcars of Chicago and New York, ministering to Italian immigrants and seeing to their varying problems and adjustments coming to a new and foreign land. And then we also had Mother Catherine Drexel, the famous Philadelphia heiress, who used her fortune to establish some semblance of a Catholic church amongst Native Americans and African Americans. And a good friend of Father Augustus Tolton, she gave him, over the course of several years, about $36,000 for the construction of St. Monica Catholic Parish at 36 and Dearborn Street on the south side. $36,000 doesn't sound too much to us today, but in the current currency of the 19th century, it probably amounted to somewhere around $400,000 in value today. Mother Catherine Drexel's founded an order of nuns, the Blessed Sacrament Sisters, who taught in several schools here in Chicago, and including St. Monica as well as St. Elizabeth's parishes here in Chicago. Ever since I was a young seminarian, we knew of Augustus Tolton. We knew of his story. Well, we didn't know that much about him. I suppose when we began to recite the names of the first in our culture, African-American Catholicism, the first priests, his name was amongst six or seven of them. He is considered to be the first of African-American descent, who was a Catholic priest serving in the United States by reason of his parents. His mother, Martha Jane, and his father, Peter Paul, who were slaves on a farm in Brush Creek, Missouri, and who escaped at the start of the Civil War to freedom through the Underground Railroad in Illinois. And we'll let you see the video that will put the facts of his life into a colorful position for you. But somehow the priests who looked over and about him noticed the seeds of religious vocation in him. And his story unravels thereafter to be a story of suffering, intolerance, discrimination, and until finally hands are laid on his head to ordain him a priest in Rome. April 24th, 1886. He comes back here to serve as a priest when before he was targeted for being sent to Borneo in Africa. But the cardinal prefect in Rome there said, you know, the United States considers itself to be the most enlightened of nations. Let's see if this is really true. Instead of sending you to Africa, we're going to send you back to the United States to serve as a priest. They had never seen a black priest before. They should be able to see one now. And that somehow sealed his fate and the kind of story and the gauntlet of experience that he would undergo, not only in Quincy, but in Chicago and in Rome. Let's see the video. Then we'll take it from there. After the video, we'll take the prayer card, and we'll see the prayer that's designed for his canonization.
The ceremony in St. James Chapel at the Quigley Center played to a full house, and well it should. In official terms, it was the proclamation and first session of the canonical trial examining possible sainthood for Father Augustus Tolton. For those in attendance, It was a big deal.
When I first heard it, I said, Uncle Gus, you have not been forgotten for all the hard struggle, the work, trying to create a place for worship for Black Catholics, an Asian, a white person, to kneel together and worship our Creator. That's what it's all about.
In March of 2010, as part of the Year for Priests, Cardinal Francis George decided to pursue the cause of sainthood for Father Tolton, the first African-American priest to serve not only in the Archdiocese of Chicago, but anywhere in the nation.
He was accepted and he wasn't. He did better up here than he did in Quincy in southern Illinois, but it was hard. And yet, in the midst of the hardship, he was very joyful. And that's what convinced me maybe it's time to declare Tolton a saint to the Catholic Church, as a holy priest who, despite the suffering, was never angry and was always persistent in his helping people to understand who Christ is and was joyful.
Cardinal George appointed Bishop Joseph Perry as the diocesan postulator for the cause for Father Tolton's sainthood, a role that Bishop Perry embraces.
During the period of slavery and emancipation and reconstruction, even through the period of segregation and discrimination thereafter, moving up to the civil rights laws and that, there is no one in this country who has emerged as a saint. In all of that history, that huge stretch there, Tolton surfaces as a minister in our Catholic tradition, someone who suffered in light of that, but still remained steadfast. He was faithful. He didn't dish back anything that was dished out to him. He tried to bring a semblance of Christian faith and Catholicity to a group of people who were not ministered to very well.
The story of Father Tolton begins amid a backdrop of prejudice and oppression. Augustus Tolton was born of slave parents, Martha and Peter Tolton, in Brush Creek, Missouri, in 1854. Augustus was baptized at St. Peter Church in Brush Creek, one of the stops on a pilgrimage led by Cardinal George in April 2011. If sainthood is in Tolton's future, his birthplace is ready to celebrate.
One county over in Boone County, where Columbia, Missouri is, we're building a brand new Catholic high school, and the people, I asked them to give me recommendations for what we would name this new high school. And the first name on the list from these people was Father Tolton. So that shows you, you know, I think we have his life is still inspiring people across the century.
One of the most heroic figures in the life of Augustus Tolton is his mother, Martha. One year after the Civil War erupted, with her husband already fighting for the Union, Martha headed toward Illinois with her three children. The youngest was a babe in arms, you know, and it was a long trek, several miles from the farm in Missouri to the Mississippi River, with bounty hunters all around. But nonetheless, they got into a boat that wasn't very seaworthy, one oar, babe in arms, and two kids, and she heroically crossed the Mississippi River. Martha and her children settled in Quincy, Illinois, another of the stops on the recent pilgrimage. Standing at Tolton's gravesite, the director of the Augustus Tolton Pastoral Ministry Program at Catholic Theological Union, Dr. Vanessa White, discusses the significance of that community in the life of Augustus Tolton.
Quincy is very important because this was the place that received both his mother, his brother and sisters and himself when they escaped slavery from Missouri. They crossed the Mississippi and arrived in Quincy. Quincy was one of the stops on the Underground Railroad. And here in Quincy, he grew, was educated, attended Quincy College, and then where he received his call to continue his studies for the priesthood.
Here he was, someone born a slave, then liberated at the time of the Civil War with his mother, moved to southern Illinois, and the Franciscan Order helped him to go to Rome and go through the Urbanianum Seminary there. He He went there with the idea that just as he wasn't acceptable as a seminarian in our country, he wouldn't be acceptable as a priest. And so he was going to go to Africa as a missionary. And it was the Roman authorities who said, look, you come from a so-called enlightened country, let them find out what an African-American priest will be. You go home.
As a priest in Quincy, he was known to be very pastoral. He was known to preach about hope. He preached about forgiveness. He preached about the church being open to all. One of the things that is surprising is that at this time, most churches, Catholic churches, were segregated. And so he, in fact, had a church where black and white both worshiped together.
As a matter of fact, Father Tolton preached so well that some white priests were upset that he was stealing their parishioners. Then, in 1889, Archbishop Patrick Feehan invited Father Tolton to come to Chicago to minister to the city's growing black population.
He worked tirelessly for the community. We know that he was very passionate. The emerging community was in the basement of St. Mary's Catholic Church, and it was the St. Augustine Society. And when he came to Chicago, the hope was that they would build a church, and they built St. Monica's. He was only in Chicago for a short time. And in fact, at the age of 43, when he was returning from a priestly retreat, he got off the train, and it was one of the hottest days of the year, and he collapsed from heat stroke. He was sent to Mercy Hospital, where he later died.
And in his death, Father Augustus Tolton leaves behind a legacy of serving his brothers and sisters despite hardships, a legacy of good overcoming evil in the name of Christ Jesus, a legacy of a son of slaves who may one day be Chicago's gift to Catholicism worldwide, Saint Augustus Tolton.
As far as the African American community is concerned, he's one of us. And he's a link with our ancestors who obviously bore the brunt of slavery and struggled in order to obtain freedom in our democracy. As far as the Catholic Church is concerned, he's a priest. He's an ideal priest of everything we know a priest should be. He leaves behind a precious legacy of memory and inspiration for priests and people at large.
He was a man of perseverance in the midst of suffering. He was a man of hope. During the time when there was hopelessness, he was also a man who was a reconciling figure, bringing peoples of different cultures together. Today, as we are living in these times, we need someone such as Father Tolton to look toward, to model in his life.
For some people, the saints can be at a distance. They lived in a distant time. They lived in a distant land. But for Father Tolton, he's one of our own. He walked our streets, he pastored a parish in our archdiocese, he rode the train. I think that the cause for the canonization of Father Augustus is a wonderful opportunity for us, the people in the Archdiocese of Chicago. He's one of our own.
He's going to be, hopefully, a Catholic saint, not just a black Catholic saint, but one that is for the whole church. And so there's an opportunity as we promote this cause to connect our communities, the black Catholic community, which too often is marginalized, that we become, have a different focus within the Archdiocese as sharing the gifts of this legacy of Father Augustus Tolton. This is a cause that is being advanced not just out of the Archdiocese of Chicago, but also the Springfield Diocese. Where Quincy is, and the Jefferson City Diocese in Missouri, where his family was a slave at Brush Creek Church. So he's a unifying figure in terms of this cause for canonization.
Side of the church, there's a cemetery. There's one cemetery for all the farmers in that whole area, including The owners of the Toltons, Stephen and his wife, Anna Elliott, there are grave markers there, and any number of other markers that are there. And then the other side of the church is the slave cemetery that has no markers and no names. A group of students from Loyola came down about 2 years ago to do some kind of, I don't know how they do it, some soundings or something in the earth, and they figure that they have noticed there's at least 80-some people buried in the slave cemetery. So they put a white cross in each and wherever they were able to locate some sounding. Some are in the backwoods and some are in the cemetery proper. The research into determining a person as saint amounts to something of a doctoral dissertation on a person's life. For which the church orders that there's a historical commission that researches and tries to gather everything that is left behind of the individual who has lived and died. If they were a writer, for example, like an Archbishop Fulton Sheen, whose cause is pending for canonization, he wrote some 67 books. So all those are amassed, and then there's a team of theologians who read those books and then examine them. Everything there is correct and right. And then there's the research into anything that exists by way of record or document about the person's life, including their own personal writings. And this particular cause is called a historical cause, simply because eyewitnesses to Tolton's life, all of them are now deceased. There are descendants of those who are deceased who knew of Tolton in an indirect way. As in contrast to a person like Archbishop Fulton Sheen, where there are still many people around who knew him, some people who loved him and those who didn't. But in addition to the historical commission, there was the theological commission, which is a commission of theologians who argue the virtues of the person's life, to somehow give some presentation that will impress the church that this is an individual who lived the Christian life, despite the circumstances within which they lived. Most of the saints lived in interesting times, some of them in some very awful times, for which a number of them were butchered because they were Catholic, or they believed in Jesus Christ, or they were devoted to the church. Martyrs. That's the theological commission. And then there's a team of canon lawyers who examine any possible miracles attributed to the intercession of the individual. This is a piece of the process that the church requires in order to make sure that it has the blue ribbon stamp of approval by God himself. In other words, the church wants to demonstrate that there is a connection between us here on earth and heaven up there with the individual, the candidate in between. One miracle of an unexplainable turnaround in health is needed for beatification, and then the following one for sanctity. And that, upon that, then the Holy Father of Rome declares the person most certainly with God. Before we move into the essays, this little prayer on the back is a prayer of our prayer of intercession to have him proclaimed a saint. It can be used for most anything whatsoever. These are passed all over the world. We get requests of these from God. South America, Africa, Russia, all over Europe, Australia, New Zealand, they come in rather frequently. But this is a common practice of creating a prayer that everyone collectively can say together and asking God to raise up this individual to the honors of the altar. Let's pray it together and then we'll move ahead. Think about something for which you wish to pray. Include in the prayer as we get to the middle of it, the middle of the text. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. O God, we give you thanks for your servant and priest, Father Augustus Tolton, who labored among us in times of contradiction, times that were both beautiful and paradoxical. His ministry helped lay a foundation for a truly Catholic gathering and faith in our time. We stand in the shadow of his ministry. May his light continue to inspire us and imbue us with that confidence and hope that will forge a new evangelization for the Church we love. Father in heaven, Father Tolton's suffering service sheds light upon our sorrows. We see them through the prism of your Son's passion and death. If it be your will, O God, glorify your servant, Father Tolton, by granting the favor we now ask through his intercession,
so that all...
may know the goodness of this priest, whose memory was large in the Church he loved. May he enjoy the kingdom of God, and we might work for the fulfillment of your kingdom. Not to us the glory, but glory to you, O God, through Jesus Christ, your Son, and our Lord. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are God, living and reigning forever and ever.
Amen.
There are four photographs of Tolton that are extant. This one is probably the most popular one. It was taken in 1890 downtown on State Street. It was the 25th anniversary of Archbishop Patrick Fian's consecration as a bishop. And they created a commemorative book with the pictures of all the priests in the Archdiocese, and this was Tolton. He was 37 years old when this picture was taken. And of course, there was no color photographs in those days. The tassel on his beretta in real life is red. In those days, it was a signal that he studied at a Roman seminary, the Pope's own seminary. So you can tell where a person was trained. Let's continue, Doctor. Thank you.
Thank you, Bishop Perry. That wonderful kind of opening up of an explanation of not only Augustus Tolton's life, but also the process of beatification, especially for those who aren't familiar with how that works. Thank you very much. And that also then provides, I think, a very wonderful introduction to the essay winners and to the essay winner who will read his essay. So I want to first introduce our second prize winner, who will not read her essay, but nonetheless, I will introduce her and say a few things about the essay. And then I will introduce our essay winner, and he will come and present to us his work. I read both of these essays, and as somebody who teaches here at DePaul and reads a lot of student essays in general, I have to say that I was very, very impressed by both of the works. To use sports language, I suppose it's really close. But I suppose there had to be one winner. So I'll begin with the runner-up, Kristen Pezzoli. Could you just stand? Congratulations. And you have to stay standing while I read you. Not to put you on the spot. Kristen's essay, titled simply Augustus Tolton, was very, very, very impressive. And I said earlier, she gave Donzell a real run for his money. Kristen hails from Kalamazoo, Michigan, and she's a DePaul junior studying sociology. She is a member of DePaul women's lacrosse team, and she also helps to organize DePaul events that broadly promote the incorporation of athletic and physical activity into academic life. Moreover, she is a member of the DePaul chapter of Alpha Phi Omega, which is a national service fraternity, and very much organized in doing that, helping out with that, and with various service events that that fraternity organizes on DePaul's campus. So again, congratulations. Mr. Donzell Leggett?
Yep.
Yes? I will say a few things about your essay. I'm going to get you to stand up. Hold on. You're going to have to come up here.
Okay.
Yeah, so you can stand while I actually say these comments if you want to. So, no, you got to stand since you're graduating. You'll get to stand. Donzell's essay titled The Road to Recognition, The Struggle for Black Identity in the Catholic Church has been awarded first prize in the second annual Bishop Augustus Tolton essay contest. This essay was impressive for its nuance, its sophistication, its historical empathy, and also its sensitivity to the theological importance of Father Augustus Tolton's life. So for that, I thank you very much, and we thank you. Donzell was born in Northwest Indiana, in the town of Crown Point. He and his family have also lived in Iowa and the Chicago suburbs, and they currently reside in Minnesota. Donzell is a DePaul sophomore, majoring in finance and minoring in Spanish, impressive. He currently serves in several different organizations. Both he and Kristen, their levels of service are very impressive. Donzell serves with the DePaul Elderly Care Society, the National Society of Collegiate Scholars, the Alpha Lambda Delta Honor Society, the Men of Color Initiative, and he will be a peer mentor for the Office of Multicultural Student Success next year. In addition, for the summer, Donzell has secured an accounting and finance internship with John Deere. Donzell, I want to present Kristen's award, and then you'll come up and give your talk, and I'll present you with your award, or Bishop Perry will present you with your award, okay? So, Kristen, if you could come up so that Bishop Perry can present you with your award.
He says this certificate is given to Kristen Pezzoli for her paper Augustus Tolton in the second annual Augustus Tolton Essay Contest, Spring Quarter 2013. DePaul University, and signed by Dr. Tia Casarella, Dr. Cherno Sisse, and me.
That's great. Another one. More.
Invite Mr. Leggett to come up to present your paper. You have to present first before we give you the award.
Of slavery and oppression, African-American Catholics kept their faith and battled through adversity to achieve the recognition they deserved, not only in the Catholic Church, but in the United States as well. black Catholic legends like Father Augustus Tolton, Mother Mathilda Beasley, and Daniel Rudd, all helped to provide a model for future generations of black Catholics. As stated by Cyprian Davis, author of The History of Black Catholics in the United States, black Catholic history began in the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 8, verses 26 through 40, when Philip the Deacon converted the Ethiopian eunuch. The eunuch interestingly came from Nubia, and the term Ethiopian was a name used for black Africans by the Greeks. This Nubian man is recognized as the first black man to enter Christianity. This moment is important in the Bible because it depicts Christianity as a religion accessible to everyone, no matter your differences. While Christianity is depicted as accessible to everyone, this idea seems to stray from interpretation of Christianity as slavery entered the soon-to-be United States. In 1565, Spanish colonists arrived in northern Florida and founded the city of St. Augustine. According to Thomas Cromwell, author of the online article, The History of African American Catholics, they brought with them Africans, some of whom were free and others whom were slaves. These Africans were Catholics. The Africans, both freed and enslaved, were ministered to by French and Spanish missionaries in their communities. Even though some of the Africans were converted to Catholicism by their oppressors, they remained proud members of the Catholic faith. This created the foundation for the black Catholic communities in the United States, such as Mobile, Alabama, New Orleans, Louisiana, and St. Augustine, Florida. Hundreds of years of oppression faced the African American community. Even white Catholic bishops and priests were slave owners during this time. It was difficult to exhibit courage and break the prejudice rules of the white man. But if progress was to be made and barriers broken, it had to begin with bravery. Mother Mathilda Taylor was born into slavery in New Orleans, Louisiana, in November of 1832. Little is known about the early years of Mathilda and the means by which she escaped slavery. As a young woman, Mathilda moved to Savannah, Georgia, and operated a school for African-American children that had to be kept a secret due to laws that prevented the teaching of free or enslaved African-Americans. The punishment for this act was a fine and whipping. Fortunately, Mathilda was able to keep her noble efforts from reaching authorities. Later in life, Mathilda traveled to England and became a Catholic nun. When she returned to Savannah, Georgia, she became the first African-American nun in Georgia, breaking the color barrier. Mother Mathilda opened an orphanage for African-American girls in 1887, and she fought tirelessly to keep it open until her death at the age of 71. Mother Mathilda earned recognition not only within the Catholic Church, but also the Protestant community as well. In her obituary in the Savannah Morning News, it is stated, "Protestants speak in the highest terms of her life and character, and among the Negroes, this feeling prevails that they have lost one of the best and truest friends and benefactors." It is remarkable that Mother Mathilda was remembered at such a high standard in one of the most racist states in the country at the time. Her testimony was inspirational to other African-American Catholic women. The recognition the African-American Catholics sought was furthered by the emergence of Augustus Tolton. Augustus Tolton was born into slavery with a Catholic mother. His father had enlisted in the Union Army in hopes of fighting for freedom for he and his family, and unfortunately ended up dying in a St. Louis hospital. At the young age of 7, Augustus was already working in the field. After his mother, Martha Jane, recognized that all she had left were her children after her husband had passed away, she took the great risk of planning an escape from slavery for her family. During these times, a runaway slave can face punishments that even resulted in death. Fortunately, Augustus, his mother, and sister were able to successfully escape slavery and cross the Mississippi into the town of Quincy, Illinois. Due to financial struggles, Augustus and his sister had to work in a tobacco factory. During the 3 months the factory was closed in the winter, Martha Jane thought that she should try to get her son Augustus an education. He attended an all-white school, but due to the hate he faced by the other students, his mother withdrew him. During his young life, he had little formal education, moving around to different schools and spending about 1 to 3 months at each school. Father Peter McGurr, who was assigned to St. Lawrence in Quincy, became aware of Augustus' troubles with public school and made arrangements for him to attend the Sisters of St. Lawrence Catholic School. Augustus' interest in priesthood came when he began serving in Mass, and later he had a discussion with Father McGurr about the possibility. Even though early education was unpleasant for Augustus, he continued to pursue his interest in becoming a priest. Although rejected by every American seminary to which he applied, Tolton was persistent and eventually able to study in Rome at the age of 26. The coursework included philosophy, theological studies, doctrinal theology, moral theology, aesthetical theology, sacramental theology, and church law. When he was not in class, Augustus kept himself busy by walking the streets of Rome and making sketches of the art and architecture of the buildings while recording their histories. In 1886, after completing his studies in Rome, Father Augustus Tolton became the first African-American priest. Father Tolton's sermons were so interesting that he eventually attracted white Catholics to his church. This proved that African-Americans can be priests and that a black priest could do just as well as a white priest. Even though it showed that race could not be a barrier in the Catholic Church, the white religious superiors thought otherwise. A white pastor in Quincy, where Father Tolton's church was, claimed that his parish's finances were being undercut due to the interracial audience Tolton was attracting. Father Tolton was reassigned to Chicago and was ordered to minister to only black Catholics. A basement is what he had to work with when he arrived in Chicago. But through fundraising, a church was consecrated in 1894 for the African-American Catholics to worship in Chicago. This struggle is important because Father Tolton's determination was not broken, even after being rejected throughout his life. The American seminaries, the white pastor in Quincy, and being given little to work with on the spot in Chicago were all excuses Tolton could have used to quit. But he showed leadership in the African-American Catholic community by standing up when times were the hardest, and he showed through example that black Catholics needed to do the same. In the late 1800s, the National Black Catholic Congress was founded by a man named Daniel Rudd. Before the formation of the Congress, Rudd had begun work on a newspaper in 1884 called the Ohio State Tribune, which later became the American Catholic Tribune. The pride of the African-American Catholics is shown through Rudd's focus statement in the newspaper in 1886 that read, "We will do what no other paper published by colored men has dared to do, give the great Catholic Church a hearing, and show that it is worthy of at least a fair consideration at the hands of our race, being as it is the only place in this continent where rich and poor, black and white, must drop prejudice at the threshold and go hand in hand to the altar." This statement summed up what African-American Catholics were feeling at the time. They felt that they were not being recognized fairly within the religion due to their skin color, and that they at least deserved to be treated fairly. Furthermore, it explained their belief that both whites and blacks should be able to celebrate the Word of God together. The importance of being recognized in the Catholic faith was further shown through the five congresses that were held. These congresses, which were held in different locations around the country, discussed the issues that concerned the African-American Catholic community. These congresses were perhaps one of the biggest successes of the African-American Catholic community. It showed that a black Catholic community actually existed and that it was active, dedicated, and proud. Another thing it gave the black Catholic community was real leadership, which was lacking in the previous years. Father Tolton was among the leaders that were a prominent part of the movement and spoke at the first Congress. The Congress started a movement that spawned key ideas such as the mass conversion of blacks and the power of the church to change racism in this country. The African-American Catholic community believed that the problem of racism could be changed in the country through cooperating with whites in religion. An interesting fact that further shows this pride and determination of the African-American Catholic community is that there were no more than two general Catholic lay congresses. Black Catholics, by contrast, had five in the 19th century. The Black Catholic congresses laid the foundation and support for the future generations of black Catholics. The Congresses drew attention to issues that concerned the future of African Americans in America, such as education and discriminatory actions in Catholic schools. These Congresses even attracted the attention of President Grover Cleveland, who invited 200 delegates to the White House at the end of the first Congress. The objective of the Congresses was best put in a nutshell by the president of the fifth Black Catholic Congress, Dr. William Lofton, who stated, "We hope to hail the day when the American people, the hierarchy of the Catholic Church and the laity, shall rise up in their might and stamp out the prejudice which is today destroying the lifeblood of the country." The African-American Catholic leaders were not only looking to better their lives, but the lives of all African-Americans in the country, Catholic or not. These leaders recognized that the power of the church could be used to improve race relations in America, creating a better future for everyone. Today, there are 3 million African-American Catholics in the United States, with 250 African-American priests and 798 Catholic parishes with predominantly black congregations. Leaders like Father Tolton, Mother Mathilda Beasley, and Daniel Rudd played important roles in the growth and recognition achieved by African-American Catholics. Hard work, determination, leadership, and courage were all qualities that led to the rise of African-Americans as a people to be recognized in the Catholic faith.
Thank you for your research and your presentation. We should publish it somewhere. Here you are. Same signatures, Dr. Castellella, Chair Nocise, and myself. Congratulations. Thank you.
So, Kristen and Donzell, thank you both very, very, very much. As a professor, I just want to say I'm always heartened to see students do work of such good quality as faculty. And I think I'm speaking for Peter here. We put all this work into our classes, and then to see students so engaged in the things we're trying to teach them, and to see students perform so well, it's actually quite inspiring. So again, on behalf of all of our audience, I thank both of you. What we will do now, essentially, is given the wealth of information that we have received, Bishop Perry has agreed to essentially have a Q&A session. And I suppose that it's a Q&A session that could very well involve our essay winners as well. And so with that, I will give the floor back over to Bishop Perry.
Thank you. Annually, we have a banquet fundraiser to help underwrite the costs that are connected with running the cause and the research connected with it. One of the highlights of that banquet fundraiser is the award that we give a woman in honor of Martha Jane Tolton, Father Tolton's mother. There's a big glass monument or trophy, whatever you would call it, and it has a boat and it has one oar that Martha Jane took to cross the Mississippi. We give that to a woman from one of the parishes in the diocese who somehow emulates the courage and the stamina and the experience of a Martha Jane relative to her own children and her own life circumstance. It's one of those awards that really goes over quite well with the emotion in the room at the time. We give them this glass award and then we give the woman $1,000. And it's always a tearjerker, but it's a special moment. Any questions you might have of me or Ms. Pezzoli or Donzell? Yes, sister.
Do I was really impressed with, first of all, it was very, very fine paper. Congratulations. I think it should be published, really. And I wish you well. The thing that strikes me the most, and I'm coming at this rather new on Father Tolman, I really don't know too much about him at all, but the thing that I really was impressed in is how young he was when he died, and the fact that it almost seemed like such a shame, because it was like he prepared so much and everything, and then to be taken at 42, 43 was rather young. But I was struck by the presence of Father Tolman in these different towns, in these different areas, and the it seemed like his educational background really prepared him deeper and deeper, but somewhere along the line, it seemed to me that the interior life, the sanctity that he had, was there, and that he was essentially a presence of someone who really lived the life. Lived the life of what an Afro-American could be in America, but also lived the life of what a good saintly Catholic could be also. And I just wanted your impression.
I think you touch on the kernel of a theme that underlaces his life story. Tolton was at the threshold of a society, our own society, that had a difficult time processing the dignity of black skin, such that a Roman collar around the neck of an African American was something of an anomaly in the majority community and a new sensation in the African American community. The whites who snuck out of their churches to go to his were saying something about Tolton. They were saying something about the church in that little town of Quincy. But to have blacks and whites worshiping together was most unacceptable. And that was the biggest charge against him that pushed him out of Quincy and into Chicago. It was small town racism, you might call it. The mayor of Quincy, he just recently died. His father used to sneak out of St. Boniface Church, which was a German parish, and go down the hill to St. Joseph Church, where Tolton was, without telling his parents, because it was forbidden. Now, the issue that got Tolton pushed out of Quincy was a young socially woman in Quincy was getting married. And apparently the man she was going to marry did not meet with the approval of her mother. So the mother went to all the Catholic priests in town and told them not to marry my daughter because I don't like this man she's going to marry. But she forgot about Tolton, but she didn't go see him. So the young woman went to Father Tolton and arranged to have her wedding. And Tolton performed the wedding, and all hell broke loose. So he was told town.
It shows the courage of the white people that would go, and because they really saw something, the depth of spiritual life, probably.
Sure. But if you consider it, in the 1870s and the 1880s, when the laws, the rubric at that time, was that the races did not mix, and they did not socialize, and they were not in the same space with each other, this was really very progressive. So progressive that people could not visually process it for themselves or process it here. And that makes him a pioneer.
I want to hear your opinion concerning the journey of Father Tolton and also the long history of civil disobedience that's inherent within the Christian religion, and how that showed through of his persistence to not only integrate, but use his own faith to free himself and through his actions others during this period of time.
You mentioned why he died so young. The average lifespan at that time during the Civil War was 45. And because most African Americans did not have access to health care. We have no
record or any information that he ever saw a doctor. And the big illnesses that were popular at that time, for especially the poor, was tuberculosis, whooping cough, hypertension, and heart disease. And the first week of July 1897, Chicago got hit by a huge heat wave. Temperatures in excess of 105 degrees. There was no air conditioning in those days. And most of the tenement housing on the south side was built out of wood. And every day, the Chicago Daily News was publishing the names of people who were found dead in their homes or on the streets. As he was getting off his train on this particular day, July 9th, 1897, it was 105 in the city. And Tolton was not all that well at that time in his life. He collapsed on the street at 36th and Ellis. He was 43. But oftentimes, our priests picked up the illnesses of the people they served, going around visiting the sick and so forth, because there was a lot of communicable diseases running around, especially the poor neighborhoods and that. Not just the blacks, it was the Irish, the Italians, the Eastern Europeans. Nobody had doctors, nobody could. But the Mercy Sisters were merciful in taking him into the hospital there. Mercy. They're very, very kind. Someone else? Yes, sir.
Can you talk about the process of what it really takes to get Father Tolton the sainthood? And also in light of the fact that Cardinal George is not going to be here that much longer in his position. Mm-hmm. And is he the driving force to get this approved? And if so, with him leaving in whatever several months or that time to be determined, who will carry the torch?
Well, the commissions, his establishment of the required commission, the historical commission, during the research on his life, and the theological commission that argues the virtues of the man, that's all put forth in these position papers that are sent on, and along with the testimonial affidavits of physicians connected with any miracles, and then the examination of the remains in his grave, all that is put together. So that goes on, irrespective of Cardinal George. He just starts it. After he retires, it still goes on with his successor. We are in at the tail end of the investigatory phase, and we're probably in the fall be able to bring that into conclusion for the historical documentary phase of his life, as well as the theological arguments for his life. We'll bring that. And we hope to maybe be able to open up his grave probably next year. And then we sit and wait and pray for God's intervention with the miracle and see what happens.
What is the significance of opening the grave? And what are they looking for?
Well, it comes from a medieval practice from centuries back to make sure that the person really existed and we didn't create him. So we have to find where he's buried and we have to open it up. And second of all, to see if he's possibly, if the person is preserved, that they did not decompose. Here and there we find a saint whose body did not decompose. Bernadette Soubirous, she's the most fantastic preserved individual who's lying in repose under glass in France. Catherine Laboure, she's another preserved body, that the body just does not decompose. It's a sign for the church that God has touched the individual and they don't have to suffer the corruption of the grave. So Rome is interested in those kinds of things, so we have to bring in a forensic expert and everybody else. And then we have to present, if there's anything left, we'll have to present that to the Holy Father at the time of canonization of the relics.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So Chicago, we've had Al Capone and Frank Nitti and many others who made our city famous. But we also have a few saints.
Catherine Drexel and Francis Cabrini, and hopefully Father Tolton. So there's a mix of the human condition. It's a part. In the meantime, the rest of us are trying to be saints. Any other questions? Or are you ready to meet? Dr. Casarella?
Well, I just want to thank everyone for coming. Bishop Perry, our moderator, Dr. Sese. It's a great privilege for the Center for World Catholicism and Intercultural Theology to be able to host this event, our second annual event. You do things twice, and you're a living tradition. That's a beautiful thing, too. There's been some popular demand in the bishop's remarks and Sister Francis for the publication of our winning essay, and I'm happy to report that the editor-in-chief of our student publication, Creating Knowledge, has accepted Donzell's essay to be published in the next issue of Creating Knowledge, and that's a great honor for him and also for the legacy of Father Tolton. I think the last thing I'd just like to do is ask the bishop maybe to bless the food so we can proceed from the recognition to the celebration.
Sure. If you wish to follow the progress of the cause, this webpage from which we downloaded the video, www.toltoncanonization.org, has all the recent updates. We try to keep it as fresh as possible so you can look that up and follow what we're doing and how we're doing it. Also, let me introduce Brother Gerard Jordan, who's a Norbertine, who's studying for the priesthood here in Chicago in Hyde Park. He's on our team for making presentations and presenting to different groups and so forth. Thanks for coming, Gerard.
Glad to be here. Thanks for having me.
Mm-hmm. Okay. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. Lord, bless our evening. Bless our brother, Father Tolton. May his cause be as special to you as it is to us. If you can name him a saint, to enlighten our communities, both white and black, and the church that he loved and dedicated his life to. May we who eat the same food share the same life that food sustains. And bless us, O Lord, and these thy gifts, which we are about to receive from thy bounty of Christ our Lord.